we'll be trying, and that's pretty much the reality of what happened in Claremont. We lost $14 million in a way that very few people, perhaps almost nobody but myself, saw coming.
Louder, please?
Sure.
I don't think the microphone's on.
I guess, is that better?
A little bit.
Okay, got it. Very good, okay. So, I am very, I think you should be encouraged by, besides the crowd here this evening, I can tell you at Claremont, even after losing $14 million, I would have a hard time getting a dozen people in a room even to find out what hit us. We've really been asleep at the wheel. We are still asleep at the wheel. It is really a remarkable, remarkable thing. I want to put that number in perspective. $14 million we have in Claremont. Claremont's about half the size of Apple Valley. We've got about 35,000 people, 11,000 households hooked up to the water system. We could have written every household in Claremont a $1,200 check for that. You know, that could have been your rebate for your water system for, you know. But we didn't. We gave it all to the lawyers. Have nothing to show for it. I did not call this a preview of coming attractions, because I'm hoping you all can avoid giving $14 million to lawyers and have nothing to show for it, no matter what you do here. That should be one of your primary goals. I've been billed as a watchdog for Claremont. That's not exactly accurate, because even though I've been barking for 4 years now, I really haven't managed to get anyone to wake up. It sort of happens in towns that if you have a little money in the bank and you have ways of covering it, until somebody gets laid off or they have to start cutting back on services, people don't take it seriously. And we're right at that edge in Claremont right now. We're going to have to borrow a substantial amount of money just to pay this off. But we're not going to, until they lay off the first city employee, I don't think anyone's going to much care about that. But I'll talk about that a little bit later. Let me just start out by telling you what I want to do tonight. I do want to tell you what went wrong in Claremont. I want to walk you through what process we went through, what sort of dynamics were in play, and how it is that we managed to, wash $14 million down the drain. I think in the course of doing that, we might identify some common areas, common concerns that you might have here in Apple Valley that are parallel to what happened to us in Claremont. And then maybe we can think about constructive responses that we can make, that you can make here in Apple Valley to hopefully have a better result than we did. Let me tell you a little about myself. I've lived in Claremont for 20 years. I've lived in San Gabriel Valley my entire adult life. My entire adult life has been in the fields of accounting and law. I started out as a Air Force officer, as a budget manager in the space program. I spent a couple years at Arthur Anderson and Company, which was the largest accounting firm in the world back in the 80s. For the last 30 years, I've been a deputy district attorney for Los Angeles County. And the last 20 years of that, I've specialized in the prosecution of major frauds. And because of my experience in seeing some very successful, very intelligent people lose huge sums of money in things that looked to be too good to be true, I was one of the few people in town who was thinking that this was going to be a problem. So that's sort of how I got involved. There had been as I presume you had here in Apple Valley, you had people, citizens groups who were trying to deal with the water problem, the high rates, everything, very sincerely, and being very active in it, and I was just sort of not thinking much about it. But when they started talking about borrowing, you know, tens of millions of dollars and doing very radical legal actions and the like, I decided to get involved. So that's sort of my background here. Well, again, we'll talk about more of that in the course of the talk. I just want you to know a little bit about my background and how I got plugged into this. I'm not a particularly political person in Claremont. I'm not active on in a lot of other issues. This is just sort of something that I ended up falling into. I've just been trying to pursue it and do the best I can to help my fellow members of the community not to lose any more money on this. And then just quickly, because I am a lawyer, I'm going to tell you that I'm speaking only for myself. I don't represent the DA's office or any other organization or any other person. I'm not giving you any legal advice here tonight, so don't say that some attorney told us we could do this or that. I mean, I will give you opinions about things that have happened in this case, but I'm not giving you any professional legal advice. And I am not an expert in civil law. I don't practice eminent domain law, I practice criminal law. Everything I had to learn about this case, I had to look it up and find out. This is any citizen would have to do. And so I just want that to be clear too. Let me tell you a little bit about Claremont. First, how many people have ever been to Claremont other than just driving by on the freeway? Oh my goodness, that is fantastic. I mean, so if you've been there, you know that although we are one of many suburbs of Los Angeles, we pride ourselves on being a little bit different than most of them. We are the one true college town in Southern California. That's our claim to fame. That is really our unique character of our town. In fact, we call ourselves the city of trees and PhDs. And as we proved beyond anyone to anyone's satisfaction, having a PhD does not make you particularly smart. But it is a beautiful town, just like Apple Valley is a beautiful town, and I don't want anything bad to happen to it. I want us to be successful don't want us to be in the paper as doing stupid things. Don't want us to go bankrupt. I want us to be a good, successful city just as you do, and that's our goal. And I think that quite frankly, that's the goal of the people who were behind the takeover in Claremont, probably the goal of the people here in Apple Valley. Everyone's trying to do the right thing. It's just whether they get off on the right track or the wrong track. Talking about what happened in Claremont and what may be happening here in Apple Valley, we first have to realize that this is a complicated issue. There are a lot of different ways, a lot of different factors that go into providing water to a community, and certainly many factors that are going to taking legal action to seize a water company from a private company and turn it into a municipal operation and all that goes into that. Obviously, there's a financial factor. What would be the effect of your rates if you did a takeover? How much is it going to cost you? How much debt are you going to have to take on? There's a legal aspect to it, obviously, a significant legal aspect to it, in terms of doing some very unique and creative things with eminent domain. There's a political aspect to it, certainly. It's a very, very big political aspect to it, I'm sure, in your town as well as ours. And there's an operational aspect of it. I mean, the idea you're going to take over a water company that's been run by somebody, engineered by them, in our case, for 90 years. We've got the same water company. It started pretty much with the city. And the idea of someone could just come in and, you know, over the weekend, take the keys over, that's a significant issue. But there's one other issue, one other factor that I think is significant, and that is the psychological factor. And quite frankly, that is what I'm going to focus on tonight. All these other aspects of areas will come up in the course of my talk. What I really want to talk to you about is how is it that a city with successful, bright, civically engaged people manage to talk themselves into something where they end up just throwing away $14 million and risk throwing away much more than that. And so that's what I want to focus on tonight. Now, they have to follow the rules. And if they don't follow the rules, they get hauled into court and gets reversed. We're a rule of law. It's evidence-based. If they want to ask for a particular, when they make what's called a rate case, every 3 years when they go in for the CPUC, they have to go in there and they got to lay out all their books, all their plans, all their costs, all their records, and all that is a public record, and all that gets debated, all that gets analyzed. So they can't hide the ball, they can't play tricks. It's a technical process. Most lawyers would have no chance even understanding this. There are special lawyers, special accountants, special consultants who just deal with rate setting. You know, it's a very specialized thing. Very technical, involves figuring depreciation on the equipment and things like that. And it's non-political. The commissioners aren't voted on popularly. You can't say, boy, we got screwed on the rate case. We're gonna vote him out next time. They're insulated from political influence. It's meant to be a completely dispassionate, evidence-based, legal thing, just like filling out your tax return. You're supposed to come to a number. But in our town, and perhaps in yours, people got the idea that we should just go and en masse to the meeting, the rate setting meeting, and say our rates are too high. And that something should happen. And now the commission does allow public comment. They do allow you to come in front of the commission and take your 3 minutes and say, our rates are too high. And you can tell them how terrible, how you can't afford to water your lawn anymore. You can barely afford to live in your apartment anymore. You can tell them all these things. And people in Claremont did. Claremont has a very large senior population. I think, you know, your town perhaps does as well. And it's easy to come up with some very real compelling stories about hardship with costs like water. And people did that. And people did it genuinely believing that it would matter. And it's not their fault. It's not their fault that they believed that. That's a perfectly legitimate expectation they had. Now, it turned out to be a false expectation, and they should have had it, but they were given that expectation by people who should have known better, who got people excited saying, we're going, we're going to make a show to the CPC, and they're going to lower our rates. Well, it didn't work, okay? And it couldn't have worked. So then the next thing is, we have to take over the system. That's the only other alternative, right? And so that's where Claremont went. As you know, most cities in California have a municipal water system. You probably heard at a town hall presentation how odd it is that you have a water system that's not owned by the city. And it is a minority thing, but it's not all that unusual. Probably a quarter of the people in the state, maybe close to a third, get their water from a regulated private utility. But the fact is, it's different than what many cities have. In our case, the city next door had lower rates. And there's a lot of reasons why the city next door had lower rates, but they're not obvious. The city next door, we're next to the city of Laverne. Laverne is very similar to Claremont in every superficial way. We have almost the same population. We're both in the same little foothill region. Very similar demographics, very similar business communities, everything. And yet their water rates were 30-40% less than ours. A big, big difference. It's hard for people in Claremont, and maybe it's hard for people now, I don't know what your comparable city is, but it was easy to find comparable cities next to us where the rates were lower. Once you see that, you begin to think, it's only logical, you start thinking, why? Why are our rates so much higher than Laverne? And you start looking at factors, and the things that leap at you is say, well, they have to pay profits to their shareholders. That's real money. And they have to pay income taxes. And the city water service, they don't have to pay profit to shareholders. They don't have to pay income taxes. That must be why we're paying 40% more for our water. That's the main thing people were concerned about Claremont. Just they felt they were being overcharged. They didn't want to pay that much. Some people in town felt very strongly just in a political sense. They wanted to have control of the water system. They felt that it was wrong to have a corporation control our water. They wanted to have control. And that was whether or not it was going to save us money or not. But most people in town really were just worried about saving some money. And they just leapt to the conclusion that we were overpaying because we had a private company that had to pay profit to their shareholders and had to pay income taxes. I'm going to share with you a great quote by a famous man named H.L. Mencken, who was a humorist in the early 20th century, who made the observation that for every complex problem, there is an answer that is clear, simple, and wrong. And that's what happened here. I'm going to walk you through quickly three case studies. And this is really what got me involved. Gardena is my hometown. I grew up in Gardena. I don't know if you know where Gardena is. Yeah. It's another suburb of LA. It's in the South Bay area. And that's where I went to school. That's where up through high school I lived there. Gardena back in the 90s was starting to have a budget crunch. And the thing that was crunching them wasn't water. It was liability insurance. Every city has to have liability insurance. It's a very important thing. Because if you get sued, if something goes wrong, you have to be able to cover it. You have to have an insurance company that's going to defend you and going to write the check if you're in the wrong. And there was a little bubble in the insurance industry in the early 90s, and cities were having a very difficult time paying for liability insurance. Now, we don't think about today, but that was a thing back then. And the people in Gardena had this brilliant idea. They looked at it and they said, gee, I wonder why our insurance rates are so high. And they said, I know, it's because the insurance company has to pay profits to their shareholders, they have to pay income taxes. And so they had this idea, they said, why don't we start our own insurance company? We'll start a municipal insurance company, we will insure ourselves, and we will sell insurance to all the other cities in Southern California, and they're going to buy it from us because we're going to be cheaper than everyone else because we don't have to pay taxes and we don't have to pay profits. So, long story short, they end up borrowing, they didn't start out borrowing $26 million, they borrowed about half of that. But almost immediately, it failed. They found out that they didn't know how to run an insurance company. And the insurance industry they solved their problem. The insurance companies rationalized they got over this bubble and they started setting rates how they should. And so Gardena is stuck with $15, $20 million worth of revenue bonds and no way to pay them. And they kept borrowing more money, trying to keep it afloat, hoping they'd turn a corner. They end up being out $26 million. By the end of that, they're taking over half of their general fund just to pay the debt, okay? And they were very fortunate. They had an assistant city manager, a guy who had just been sitting there, not running the show, but watching it unfold in front of his eyes. So they fire the main guy, and they promote him, and he turned out to be a brilliant man. And he went and renegotiated the debt with the banks, cut the police department in half. And in Gardena, in the 90s, that was a radical thing to do. Gardena was not the best neighborhood in the 90s. It's a very nice neighborhood today, but it had a little rough patch. And to lay off half your police department, just to keep afloat, just to keep from going bankrupt. That was Gardena. Hercules, anyone know where Hercules is?
Northern California.
It's just about north of Oakland. Okay, it's on the East Bay. Small town, it's probably got 10,000 people. Do you remember, we're talking about water today, but back about 20 years ago, 15 years ago, we were talking about what? We were talking about electricity, about power. Do you remember that?
We're talking about that now, too.
Yeah, but that's how Arnold Schwarzenegger became governor. Gray Davis couldn't figure out how to deal with the power crisis. And everyone was having the same arguments we're having over water they were having over power back then. Everyone's electricity rates were going through the roof and didn't know what to do about it. So Hercules said, I know, PG&E, which is their privately investor-owned, regulated utility, they have to pay profits to their shareholders, they have to pay income taxes. So why don't we just start our own power company? And that way, we can just charge, we don't have to charge profit, whatever, and we can cut rates to our customers. And that didn't work either. Again, they had this great feasibility studies. They were right off the bat, they thought they were ahead of schedule for making this work. And of course, they were just a disaster. I'll tell you about this. I don't know what your plans are for financing your water system if you would buy it. In Claremont, we were gonna use revenue bonds. And I'll just take a quick tale of what a revenue bond is. Revenue bond says, the lender lends you money, and the only source of his repayment is the profit from the business he's lending money against, the water company. So the idea in Claremont is this is safe because water companies always make money. And even if somehow they couldn't make their payments, they can't come after you, or they can't come after the city. All they can do is come after the water company. But that's really now no solution because it's not an option for you to have a water company go bankrupt. You need water. So it was not an option for Hercules to lose money on their electrical utility. They had to start raiding money from their general fund every month to subsidize their losses. Mind you, their rates were 30-40% higher than PG&E had been charging. And they still couldn't do it. At the end of it, they end up losing $9 million. And they were only able to avoid bankruptcy because the bonds had been downgraded so low to junk status that PG&E bought them back out, and that was that. Monticello, Minnesota, as a little town north of the Twin Cities. This was really crazy. They decided, this wasn't water or electricity, this was broadband internet service. They felt that they were not competitive with other little towns in Minnesota because they did not yet have high-speed fiber optic internet service or whatever. And they were tired of waiting for the local utility to, you know, regulated telecom company to put in. So they had the bright idea, well, we'll borrow $20 million, do it ourselves. And that one they did go bankrupt. That one they did default on the, they didn't go bankrupt, they had to default on the bonds. And a lot of people lost a lot of money on that. But, so that's what I knew when the very first meeting I went to in Claremont. I knew about Gardena. I didn't know about Hercules or Monticello yet, but I looked those up too. Because I was looking for a successful example of a successful takeover. I wanted to see, because I hope to say, look, do it like these people. Isn't that what you want to do? Don't you want to find a city that did it and say, let's copy them. And that way they've made the mistakes, they figured out the right way to do it. Let's just copy them. Well, guess what? There's nobody to copy. There's nobody. Not in water, not in power, not in telecom, nothing. Well, it's just, you cannot find an example. But nonetheless, Claremont got in the business of selling the dream of taking over the water company. And how do you sell this dream? First, you start with grassroots activism. This is real live grassroots activism. This is two guys at the local health club just bump into each other one day and somehow water rates come up and they both start talking about, boy, our water is too high, whatever. And out of that, they decide they need to start a group called Claremont Outrage. And that became the genesis of it. They got everyone in town worked up. I'll talk about it a little more later. I'll tell you specifically a little more. Second thing is appraisal. You'll hear, I'll talk about appraisal, that's very important. Feasibility study, I'm sure you've had one of those by now. Town hall meeting, if you had a town hall meeting, yeah, I think you have. You look just like ours, same people too. And you had an election, okay? Okay, let's talk about the grassroots. Claremont Outrage, there were literally two guys, two fellows in the community, were never had been particularly active in anything, but one fellow, he's got 4,000 square foot house on an acre of land. So his water bill's high, okay? And it's not desert, he's got a lawn, you know? And so he was obviously paying a huge water bill every month and he wasn't happy about it. And the other fellow wasn't happy about his water bill. And they decided we need to get the community organized and do this. And they found 5 sympathetic ears on the city council and got everyone worked up on it. And this was originally their plan was to go to the PUC and say, you've got to cut us a break on our rates. And they got widespread support on that. And it never occurred to anyone to push back to it. Again, like I say, me and everyone else were thinking, okay, our water rates are too high. Go for it, you know? Yeah. Once that failed and we started to do the takeover thing, then we had a group called Claremont Flow. And you probably, do you have an Apple Valley Flow? Friends of locally owned water?
They're hidden.
They're here. But the acronym, everyone's Flow was the catchword. Ohio has a flow, Felton up in Northern California had a flow. Everyone who's trying to do this has a flow group, Friends of Locally Owned Water, it's a clever acronym. And they are the ones who sort of are pushing the takeover. We have one in Claremont. And again, run by very nice people, pillars of the community. Nobody's trying to make a buck on this. They think they're trying to help, you know. Our local newspaper, we have, uniquely in Southern California, the suburb suburban part of LA, we have a very influential local newspaper. You know, I mean, there's most everyone else just gets a part of the regional paper. We have something called the Claremont Courier. It's been in town for 100 years, and it is our go-to paper, and they are very influential, and they got behind us from day one. And, you know, and that's pretty much, there's not getting around that. There's no alternative media in town to bring other voices into it. And endorsements. They did round up everybody who'd ever been on city council, anyone ever been on a commission, anyone ever been on the Chamber of Commerce, all to write letters, all to say, this is what we got to do. And we did. An appraisal. Let's talk about appraisals. By law, if you want to take property by eminent domain, you have to have an appraisal. Okay? Now, if they want to take my house to build a freeway, the appraisal is pretty easy. They just look and see what the house next door sold for, and then they know what my house is worth, right? And it's very easy to appraise properties. It's a very simple, straightforward thing in most cases. But the appraisal is legally required. There's no standards, there's no rule, there's no state guidelines for the appraisal. The appraiser's industry has their own professional guidelines, whatever, but they're not legally binding. Nobody has the experience in appraising a water company for sale. I mean, water companies don't get sold. I mean, not in a forced sale, at least. This never happens. Every now and then, like Liberty bought your water company, but that was a negotiated sale. There was no appraisal. They just figured out what they wanted. And it's non-binding. This appraisal doesn't bind anyone. It doesn't bind the city. It doesn't say the city has to pay this much. It doesn't bind the company that you're trying to buy it from. It doesn't bind anyone. It's just a number. It's very rare to have a contested valuation. I say eminent domain is usually taking somebody's property. Usually it's a parcel property we're taking because we got to build something. Okay? And we're talking about a piece of real property. It's usually very simple what it's worth. And it'd be crazy for you if every house in your neighborhood is selling for $200,000 and you say, well, I think it's worth $300,000. It'd be crazy for you to contest it. No lawyer would take the case. You know, and you'd end up wasting a lot of time. And for what? You know, I mean, a jury would come back and say, no, it's worth $200,000. So most people can negotiate or figure out what appraisal's worth. The way it works is the jury decides the value. What'll happen in Apple Valley, what'll happen in Claremont, if you ever get that far, we're not likely to get that far. But had the judge say we had the right to do this, you go in front of a jury, and the city puts on their evidence, their expert who says, we think, in Claremont's case, we think it's worth $55 million, okay? And the water company, Golden State, has already told us, they're gonna say, we think it's worth over $200 million. And then, what the jury's gonna do is what you and I would do. They're gonna split the difference. And that's what they always do. I mean, there's not that many cases, large dollar value cases, that have gone to trial and had jury verdicts. But there are law professors, one of whom I had in law school, who make it their business to study these things and do reports and studies of what happens on large eminent domain verdicts. And that's what happens. They split the difference. And they favor the property owner a little bit. They don't quite split the difference. They actually give a little more to the property owner because they look at him as the victim, I think. You know, I mean, he didn't want to sell. Here's some recent appraisal things with water. The city of Big Bear Lake, and I think maybe, I don't know if you're familiar, Big Bear Lake was the one water company that got taken over in the 80s by eminent domain. And that's really the only one I can think of where a city actually had to, took it over by eminent domain without it being a consensual sale, where it actually went to a verdict. Their appraisal was $10.4 million. The jury came back at $22 million. Felton, this was more recent, that's up in the Santa Cruz area, they had an appraisal, they asked for $5.3 million, the jury came back at $13.4 million. Montero, which is Half Moon Bay area, $5 million came at $11 million. I say, Claremont, I can predict we're going to pay at least $127 million. And I would bet money on that. I don't think you can't find a case where they went below splitting the difference. They always go higher. So splitting the difference is $127 million. We can't afford $127 million. We're wasting our time. Okay, I don't know what your numbers are. But I already knew beginning, we never had a chance anyway, because we won't get this far. But if we get this far, we still lose because we can't afford $127 million. You have a feasibility study. Again, assumptions are everything in a feasibility study. You know, you can make a feasibility study come out any way you want if you put the right assumptions in. Okay? And since it's such a complicated thing you're talking about, it's easy to not make it exactly comparable. You have to have a very, very elaborate study if you want to make sure everything's comparable. Comparing us to the city of Laverne, for example, has to take into account all kinds of factors that nobody even thinks of. I mean, the city of Laverne is as old as Claremont, but most of the houses were built in the last 30 years. So they have brand new pipes. We have 90-year-old pipes. You have to take that into account. You have to take into account our elevation. We have to pump water up 1,000 feet. We have a big elevation. We go from 1,000 to 2,000 feet in Claremont. It takes a lot of fuel to pump water uphill. That's all these things happen. No such thing as a small error. You're talking about 30 years and tens of millions of dollars. If you make a small assumption of 1 or 2%, it can make an enormous difference over what the costs are going to be. And finally, nobody's accountable. It's not like there's any standard or anyone. You can't hold somebody does a study. There's nobody to say, oh, you screwed up the study. Nobody's ever used you again. It's all very anonymous. Nobody cares. In our case, the city refused to publicly disclose the study, which should have been a pretty big flag, don't you think? I asked them over and over again, every which way, every formal way. I've documented it. I've got all the emails, everything, saying, let me see the study. Because I'm an accountant. I wanted to see the study. I wanted to see if the numbers made sense. And they wouldn't do it. Finally, they had to do it because the water company sued them under Public Records Act, and they gave it up. And it turns out the study just turned out to be a spreadsheet, a 90-page spreadsheet with no explanations, no conclusions, no nothing, just spreadsheet with some graphs at the end. It was ridiculous. And then when I got that, I said, give it to me in the Excel format so I can manipulate the numbers. I can see, you know, change assumptions and things. Oh, no, we don't have that. We just have a printout. I mean, please. Turned out the assumptions were false. It took me a long time to figure it out because it was a mess. But they were up by $100 million. $100 million. And at trial, they got caught. The other side brought in their expert to say, you know, you're off by $100 million. You know, just as I told them. And the judge wasn't happy about that. You know, the fact that Claremont was saying we're going to save money when, in fact, we weren't going to save money. We were going to cost everyone a lot of money. And that was a very bad thing. We had a town hall meeting. I looked at your town hall meeting. I asked Dan to send me a copy of your ones. The slides were the same format, same everything. They are almost identical. And same with Mr. McVeigh. I think he probably presented yours from BB&K. He presented ours. He tweaked it a little bit, but pretty much it's almost the same thing. But let's talk about town hall. What's a town hall meeting? It's an informational meeting. It's to let the people in town know this is what our grand idea is. The council says, we're keeping an open mind. We haven't made any decisions yet. We don't know what we're going to do. We're just going to keep an open mind. We're going to be transparent and have our due diligence. Those are the buzzwords. And in our town, at least, the councilmen really believed that they said the words transparent and due diligence, that it meant that they were being transparent and doing their due diligence. And you have experts. And again, it's very hard to argue with an expert. It's impossible to argue with an expert, even when I was convinced I knew better than them. You get 3 minutes. You know, you get 3 minutes in a meeting. I can't argue with an expert in 3 minutes. And I don't get to question it. I can do it, I did it, and they say, oh, Mr. Belna's wrong, and that's it. That's the end of the story, you know? Let's face it, the dynamics are telling me 100% of the attendees want lower water rates, right? I mean, who's there who doesn't want lower water rates? And 99% of attendees are uninformed about how water rates are actually determined. And I'm being generous there. It's probably 100%, but I'm allowing maybe somebody knows. You get an incomplete and biased presentation of the pros and cons. And I don't mean that in the sense that they were intentionally doing it. Maybe they were. I just mean it's impossible in the span of a meeting where you have to present everything within 45 minutes or an hour to actually fully inform everybody of all the things that can go wrong, all the assumptions you're making, all these things. You can't do it. So you pick and choose. And, you know, you're likely to pick and choose the things that emphasize the way you think the meeting should go. Emotion over facts, that's a big thing. Maybe you've seen this in meetings. People got very emotional in our town over this. I mean, they were in tears over how they've been abused by this water company, okay? I don't know. That's not my job to say whether, you know, how much pain they have. I think they did have pain. But, you know, that's not a substitute for facts when you have to make a decision that's going to have millions of dollars of impact on your budget. And the one line that was most effective was, we need to do this for our children and our grandchildren, right? I mean, we're not doing it for ourselves. That'd be selfish. We're doing it for... Now, they were honest about it, because believe me, none of us are going to live long enough to see a dime out of this thing. Our children aren't going to live long enough to see a dime out of this thing. It's theoretically possible your grandchild may get a little bit of rate relief, okay? Then we had an election. Now, we just had one election. And our election was just to authorize the bonds in case we want to go ahead, just so we're ready, you know, just so we got everything in place. And we authorized $135 million of revenue bonds. Now, mind you, we had appraised the thing at $55 million. Everyone in town is led to believe we're going to pay $55 million, but somehow we're approving $135 million of bonds, which is kind of odd, right? I mean, if imagine if a real estate agent comes to you and says, you know, you say, I want to buy that house, and he says, well, it's listed for, and it's appraised for $100,000, but you need to take a loan out for $200,000 just in case we have to pay that much, right? I mean, it's crazy, right? But anyway, we were just approving bonds. We weren't approving the takeover. And, you know, the city gets to define the measure. They get to write the language. They get to do all that stuff. And the water company doesn't really have a say in this. I mean, technically, they did get a PR firm, and they made signs, and they put them up. But nobody wanted a sign in their yard. I was the only guy in town with the signs in my yard. But they foolishly, in my opinion, they put them on. They the night before the election, they put them all over town, like as if somehow people wouldn't think it was just the water company putting up these signs. And, you know, it was kind of a lame move on their part. But the reality is, all we're doing is proving bonds in Claremont. That's not the water companies. The water company can argue you shouldn't take us over, but the water company wouldn't have standing to say you can't borrow money or whatever. But what happens is, once you pass the election, all of a sudden it passed with 71%. I wrote the argument against. I'm proud to say I kept it under 30%. You know, I got almost 30% of people to agree with me. But the point is, once it passes with a 70% majority, the council then takes that and says 70% of the people approve of taking over the water company. And we have a mandate to do it. It's our job. We have our marching orders. Come hell or high water, we have to take over the water company. Now, this is what I wrote in my ballot argument. No California city has ever successfully taken over its water utility in a contested eminent domain trial, and it will probably take years of litigation and millions of dollars just to find out if we have the legal right to do so. We could lose in court and have nothing to show for it but a massive hole in our budget. Okay? That was actually pretty prophetic, right? Yeah. And the mayor passed with 71% of votes. What happened next? Our city council passed a resolution of necessity. I think you've done that already in Apple Valley, too. We did it twice, because the first time the lawyer screwed it up. And when it's their fault. I mean, they're supposed to know better, but nobody's ever done this before. We're the first ones. Claremont's the first one ever to do it. You're second. Okay, congratulations. You're number two. Ojai's number three, okay? Not do over again. So they did that. We had a court trial on the issue of necessity. Now, what do you think? Okay, put your judge's hat on. You're a judge, okay? I've all made you judges. And I say, your decision is it necessary for the city of Claremont to take over the water system from Golden State Water? What are you going to look at? You're going to look at the cost, right? And you're also going to look at the experience and the, of the operators. You're going to look at things like that, right? Are these people qualified to run a water system? Can they do it more cheaply? Can they do it more effectively? Are there any other advantages? And as I told the city many times, I said, you know, you're going in here thinking that the judges just have to decide it's something you want to do, okay? And that's not the standard. It's not something you want to do. It's not even something that's good to do. It's something that you have to do, okay? So some cities, Ojai has a little better case. Because OI can make a case that they've had, they're isolated, and they don't get the response that some other cities get, and they have some leaky pipe issues and things like that. And they have an experienced water district right next door that's just going to take it over. Claremont had none of that. We just, you know, we're crazy. We're just saying, and we came in and said, we want it because we need it because we had 70%, this is literally our argument. We are so smart, city of PhDs, right? We are such a smart city that we really need to control our water, you know? We really deserve it. And the judge laughed at that, of course, you know. And, ultimately, it came down to the fact that at any price point, $55 million up to $120 million, that's what our study ran, it was gonna cost the ratepayers, our rates were gonna go up for the next 30 years at any price we paid for. That's what the facts showed in the trial. Let me talk about this. Well, first, the bottom line, we lost $14 million. 6.2 was that was our cost, our legal cost. And I have to say, I'm in the wrong end of the law business, because $6.2 million, that's over 4 years. That would be me and 11 of my colleagues working full-time for 4 years to bill that. I mean, you know, what the county pays me, okay? But they managed to run up $6 million on a preliminary issue. This is not even the meat of an eminent domain thing. So, and then we had to pay Golden State $7.7 million. The city went to court trying to cut that down. That was heard yesterday morning. The city was hoping that they could convince a judge to knock it down, that the fees request by Golden State was too high, that their lawyers charged too much, they charged for work that didn't count. They thought they could cut down to $3 or $4 million. And after all that, the judge knocked off $30,000. So we're on the hook for $14 million. Okay. Anyway, here's why we lost, and you need to pay attention to this part. First of all, I said it's a case of first impressions. Never happened before. We're the first guys, you'll be number two, who did this. And again, Beth Spencer Krieger gave every impression of not even being aware of what the law was, what the legal standard was. I don't know if they are or not. They're not going to tell me, okay? But they never told the council. I told the council, but Beth Spencer Krieger never told the council. They never said, you know, this has never happened before, and there's a risk you could lose this, and their bill, and if you do lose, it's going to cost you $14 million. Those words never said at any meeting in Claremont. I already told you about the seriously flawed feasibility study. What they did was, here's some real back of the napkin math. For our water system, the rate of return, that's the profit that supposedly we're paying to Golden State shareholders in our rates, and the income tax effect of that, worked out to about $5 million a year, okay? Over 30 years, it's pretty constant, about $5 million. The debt service, the cost it would cost, what it would cost us to pay the principal and interest on the money we'd have to borrow to pay for the system over 30 years. If we got it at $55 million, which is impossible, because no jury's ever gonna give us at $55 million, was $6 million a year. At $120 million, which is the lowest possible price we could ever get it for, but the highest we could afford to pay, at $9 million a year, okay? The $4 million in the hole every year for 30 years. You know, do the math, okay? It just doesn't work. And it didn't impress, so they had to make it work, though. So what they did was, they did a little stupid accounting trick. Claremont, Golden State Water runs about a dozen maybe more than that, water systems throughout the state, maybe like 20 or 30 even. But they run about 8 of them in Southern California. And they were allowed to go to the PUC, and instead of doing a separate rate case for Claremont, they can take all the Southern California systems they run and do one rate case. So it includes Claremont, includes some cities in Orange County.
Includes part of Apple Valley.
Includes part of Apple Valley, some other places out here in the desert, Wrightwood, San Gabriel Valley, some different, anyway, there's like 8 different. We argued, somehow somebody in Claremont got the idea that we were being screwed on this deal. That actually, because of regional rates, we were overpaying by 16%. That if you actually looked at what our water actually costs, that it would be, we would have, we're overpaying. And then they refined that to 10%. So they said, we're overpaying by 10%. They used that number, and they inflated Golden State's revenue requirements for 30 years by 10%, okay? Now, I kept asking them, show me the study where it shows that we are overpaying. And I never get a response. No response. They just don't answer. So finally, in frustration, I spent one weekend, and all the information is right on the CPUC website, and I just did the math myself. And I did a study. I looked at all 8. I used the same methodology as our feasibility study. I looked at all 8 systems. I did the math. I found out, first, over a 10-year period, Claremont overpaid by less than 1%. Some cities, Orange County, overpaid by 25%. You people out here in the desert are getting a break like you can't believe. Now, if at least in the Golden State part of it, I know how it works for you. All the desert mountain regions of Golden State are heavily subsidized by the suburban system. It has probably to do with your fixed costs, whatever. You probably have lower volume. A lot of it has to do with your water supply, things like that. But whatever reason, the rates for Apple Valley, for example, were probably 60% lower than they would have been if Apple Valley had to stand alone and make a rate case. But Claremont, it turned out to be right on the number, you know. And then at trial, of course, they don't bring me. They bring a PhD in economics to do the same analysis I did in front of the judge. And the judge says, where's this 10.3%? And he puts a spreadsheet right in the opinion, okay, just to rub it in, saying here it shows that actually, you know, actually the economist was better, but he showed that we were advantaged by like 2%. And he put that right in the opinion, okay, just to emphasize how upset he was at this phony study the city was relying on. But the best part of all was this. In our case, very early on, our city manager decided, I think as a political tactic, that it wouldn't be very attractive to say, we're going to start a water company from scratch. That means, because people are sensitive to building a bigger bureaucracy in your city and take on more employees, more retirement contributions, things like that, you know, all the overhead of it. So it would be very clever. We'll just find a local city who we'll just turn this over to. And they can, on a contract basis, they'll operate our water system. That sort of defeats the whole purpose of local control, doesn't it, when you're just turning it over to the city next door. But that was our plan. So we said, we're going to let Laverne run our water system. Laverne runs their own water system. They can just run ours. Now, there are 2 problems with that. One, if you tell Laverne, you're the only people we're going to deal with, and we're relying on you to do this, you can imagine what kind of deal you get from the city of Laverne. They're going to balance their budget on it, and they did. They came up with a very extraordinarily beneficial contract for them. They were making, Golden State makes an 8% return. They were making 10%, okay? But the joke turned out to be on them. Our attorneys, Bespis and Krieger, your attorneys too, spent almost $4 million prior to the trial just on developing the case, reviewing things, all these things. I don't know what they were doing. One thing they were doing was looking at Laverne's water system. Even though they negotiated the deal for us and the whole thing, it didn't occur to them that when you're talking about a case, is it necessary to take over the water system, the judge might look and say, well, how does Laverne compare to Golden State in terms of running a water system, right? It turns out, not very well. Laverne, you heard of Flint, Michigan, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Guess who's the Flint, Michigan of Southern California?
Oh, God.
Laverne, there's a federal lead standard, okay? And that's what Flint got burned on. And that's what Laverne violated. And they violated it like four or five times over a span of 4 or 5 years. Now, it sounds very dramatic. And it is. Lead poisoning lead's a serious health issue. And the federal government, everyone takes this very seriously, okay? And they had to report it. Now, the other problem they had was they also required to file a report with the state and with the community. You get, whether you ever read it or not, in one of your bills every year, they send you a confidence report on your water system, whether you know it or not. And
we call it water quality.
Water quality, whatever. Your water company has to say, here's how we did this year on water quality, okay? It's a legally required thing. Well, Laverne didn't want to send a letter out to everyone in the community saying we violated the lead standard, and they also had an E. coli issue too. Now, again, these were, you know, I mean, I don't want to be overdramatic, but I mean, this was real, you know? And so they fudged the numbers on their report. And Golden State, who spent their money better than Best and Krieger did in terms of pretrial preparation, found this. It wasn't hard to find. It's all in public records. They didn't have to subpoena anything. They just went on the website and looked at the water quality reports, and there it was. You know, Laverne had been cited like 3 years in a row for lead quality violations. And Golden State had never been cited. And so that came up in the middle of trial, out of the blue. Okay, you can imagine what that day was like in trial. When the Golden State says, oh, by the way, we want to call, you know, the Laverne, we want to ask Laverne about their water quality. People in Laverne didn't know about it. You know, I mean, it was a very, very difficult, in this case, we're out money, but Laverne is hurting worse than we are in some ways. And the lawyers didn't really understand the legal presumption. There's something in the law called a presumption. It means you get to go in winning the case unless somebody presents evidence to show that they should win, okay? And that's the way those laws written. Well, somehow the city thought that because they had this presumption that they automatically win, and that's not the way it works. And they know this. I mean, they just were careless about it or indifferent to it. And Golden State came in and put on a very persuasive case, and the city was completely unprepared to respond to it, and then lost. Yeah, I'll be quick. Okay, post-trial reaction. Of course, everyone in town is convinced just the judge was a bad judge, okay? I mean, that's a typical reaction in Claremont. We got screwed by the judge. That's what I always say when I was a trial. Let's see. We're appealing, or we're thinking about appeal. We filed an appeal. We really don't have grounds for an appeal. And I think this is a face-saving gesture, and sometime after our council elections next month, I think they'll withdraw the appeal. We're going to have to issue a bond, probably a $10 million bond, just to pay what we owe Golden State's lawyers. Nothing for it. We're arguing over building a new police station. It's going to cost us $25 million. And we can't get that off the ground because it's too hard to figure out how to build a police station for only $25 million. But now we've just thrown away $10 million just to lawyers. Our council members have all been endorsed by the local papers, and I expect they'll easily win re-election. And the same, like a week after the verdict came down, the final verdict from the judge, we gave our city manager a 10% merit raise. I'll be real quick, this is an important part. We have a conflict of interest. You have a conflict of interest. Your city attorney is from BB&K. Your lawyers are from BB&K. And your litigation team, should you get that far, is going to be for BB&K, okay? So in other words, the same lawyers who right now are putting on these shows, putting in front of council saying, here's all the reasons, all the pros and cons. Well, they have a conflict of interest, don't they? I mean, they're supposed to be giving you neutral advice on whether it makes sense or not to proceed. But if you don't proceed, that's the end of their fees. If you do proceed, $6 million, okay? Now, I want to be very clear here. I'm not saying that's unethical. I'm not saying that's illegal. I'm not even saying that's their motivation. I'm saying that is an appearance. That's a conflict. whether they act on it or not, and I'm not saying anything about their motives, anything about their competency, anything about their ethics, they may be doing a wonderful job for your city. Maybe they did a wonderful job for ours. But the point is, that conflict is there. And when they do send the $6 million, their own person in the city is the one who's going to decide whether it gets paid or not, okay? And I say, we just went through, we paid a consultant to try and attack the money, the fees we had to pay Golden State's lawyers. We're not going to hire that consultant to look at our own legal fees and see if we can save some money, okay? There's all the things that went wrong. They didn't tell us that we had, that the water company would fight us in court. They didn't tell us that we could lose that fight. They didn't tell us that if we lost it, we're going to be up $14 million. They didn't tell us, they haven't told us, we didn't get this far, that if we ever got to a valuation trial, that there's no way the jury's ever going to set a price we can afford, which means it's over anyway, right? And if it failed for any other reason, we're on the hook for all their legal fees, okay? And the worst case of all, I want to leave you with this. We dodged the bullet. We can afford to lose $14 million. What we could not afford, we maybe could have afforded to lose $20, $25 million, which is maybe what we lost if we went all the way.
Who is we?
It's Claremont, City of Claremont. We could not afford to take over their water system. We would have been like Gardena and Hercules and Monticello, okay? That is the bullet we dodged, okay? The judge got us off the hook of that, because if we got all the way and bought this thing, we're the dog who caught the tire, you know? I mean, you know, there's no end to the amount of disaster will happen if you actually take over a water system. And I say, everyone had their heads in the sand. They didn't care about all the other cities that could make this work. They didn't care about all the facts that were given to them. I'm going through this pretty quick. There's all stuff we already sort of talked about. The bottom line, as far as I'm concerned, is the only thing worse than losing $14 million is having to admit you made a mistake. You know, I mean, that's really sort of how it is in our town. You know, people are dug in. They have a lot, you know, at stake here. And this is the reality check. People make decisions on emotion instead of facts. They put too much trust in experts. They tend to be optimistic about things that they want to have come true. They typically lack the will and desire to seriously engage complex problems. They will not accept failure until it becomes impossible to rationalize it away. Yeah. And you'll give up a lot in order to save face. Yeah. You know, you're willing to spend $14 million is cheap if it means not having to say you're sorry. And what can we do? Okay. First, I love Claremont. I'm an unofficial head of the Chamber of Commerce, I think. I think Claremont's a wonderful city I know of. That's not because I don't know Apple Valley well enough to compare. I'm sure you're just about. But the point is, it's a beautiful city, but for gosh sakes, use this as an example, okay? We did a very stupid thing, and we should be the canary in the coal mine. You know, I mean, anyone who thinks that they're going to have an easy road based on what we did, I think you're fooling yourself. Say, make a record. I have kept every email I ever sent to the council. I've got probably 50 of them, okay? And they were all respectful, all right on point, all just asking questions or making observations, factual observations. Never got in a debate with these people, never argued with them, never questioned their motives, but I made a record. I made a record. You can go back and say, here, this, 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 and this, you know? And that's important. Focus on the near-term issues. It's easy in this case, and that's sort of how I got off track. You start thinking about what's going to happen when you take over the water company. Well, forget about that. That's not happening. Think about what's happening right now with this lawsuit coming up, okay? That's where you have to focus, and that's where you're going to lose $14 million. I mean, you know the number now. You're going to lose $14 million. Focus on that. Force them to tell you how they're going to get a different result than Claremont, how you're not risking losing $14 million like we did. That's what you need to focus on. Don't worry about their projections of savings, everything. You should focus on the immediate issue, in my opinion. Focus on process, not politics, not political issue. But make them, hold them accountable to doing the right things, doing things the right way. Insist, send them a message, I want to see this, I want to see that, I want you to justify this. You know, don't argue with them over it. Just say, show us this, you know? and then you have a record when they don't. Hold the lawyers and the politicians accountable, okay? I mean, that's what they're paid for. Now, the politicians, I mostly mean the lawyers. You know, at this point, you should expect yourselves and your counsel to be pounding on Bespas and Krieger to explain what happened in Claremont. They're not going to answer it, okay? But I mean, that in and of itself is going to be probably the best argument you can make, that your own lawyers are not going to tell you how they lost that case. And finally, and this is my very last point, understand our common human limitations. I've been, you know, I've been criticizing the judgment of people in my town for 4 years now. I have never criticized their motives. I've never criticized their intentions. I've never, you know, I've been very cordial. I understand. I believe that they are convinced that this is the right thing to do, and they were doing it for all the right reasons. I don't think there's anyone in my town. I'm not talking about the lawyers. I don't know about the lawyers. But certainly the politicians, people on the council, people in my community, all think they're doing the Lord's work on this. And I think they're completely sincere about it. I think they're wrong, but they're sincere. And there are worse things than losing $14 million. That's tearing your town apart over nasty personal fights, you know. So we've been fortunate in Claremont. We've avoided that. We at least have a good sense of community, you know, and it's a very important thing. So there's a way to do it. You can do it respectfully. And obviously you've been doing that here too. And I just want to point out that I think ultimately we may get some relief in Claremont. There may be some things we could do to get some of that money back. I don't know. But at least we fought the good fight. And that's the end of my talk. That's just sort of what happened in Claremont. I hope that's helpful to you.
Jim, and that's some wise advice, and we will have a question period, but right now everybody stand up and kind of shake it out. You've been sitting about an hour and a half.